It's my real pleasure to welcome you all to the University of South Australia and to what I'm sure will be an entertaining and informative evening. But before I introduce the keynote speaker for tonight, I'd like to give you a bit of a sense of why we're here. The Enterprising Research Talk series was launched in 2016 and showcases the effective partnerships our researchers form with end users, industry and the community, and that's something we'll really be looking at today. We take particular pride in these partnerships and that our researchers work collaboratively right from the conception of a research idea, allowing our research directions to be shaped by the opportunities and the challenges that our partners face. And it's these efforts that have led to UniSA recently being ranked as number one in Australia for industry research income by the Times Higher Education World University Rankings. But tonight's talk is all about small satellites, CubeSats, and how they are taking over space. Together with industry partners, our keynote speaker for tonight, Associate Professor Gottfried Lechner, will explore the opportunities and challenges that come with the massive growth of CubeSats in recent years. So now let me introduce Gottfried to you. Gottfried Lechner is Associate Research Professor and Director of the Institute for Telecommunications Research at UniSA, where he leads a team of academic researchers, engineers and postgraduate students. Originally from Austria, Gottfried completed 2 degrees at Vienna University of Technology and worked as a software developer before joining the Telecommunications Research Centre Vienna as a researcher. Since he joined UniSA in 2008, his research has included areas such as error-correct encoding, signal processing, wireless communications, satellite communications, software-defined radios, and quantum key distribution. And I'm sure he's going to explain what some of those mean for you tonight. Gottfried contributed to several funded research projects ranging from fundamental research to applied research and consulting. He delivered key solutions to the project Global Sensor Network, and I know he's going to tell you about that, which was awarded Technology of the Year 2013 and attracted international investors, resulting in the spin-off company Myriota. Gottfried is also the program leader, Advanced Communications, in the newly commenced SmartSat CRC. So over the next hour, Gottfried and his partners will discuss the opportunities and challenges of CubeSats before we'd like to invite you to ask any questions and then join us for some drinks and nibbles afterwards. So please join me in welcoming Gottfried Lechner.
Thank you, Emily. So thanks for the introduction, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to talk a bit about our research here at UniSA. Satellite revolution, it sounds fairly big, and it is indeed a very exciting time in Australia and especially in Adelaide. If you look back 2 years ago, pretty much 2 years ago, in September 2017, Adelaide hosted the International Astronautical Congress, where we had approximately 4,500 attendees, which I think is the largest conference Adelaide ever had. At this conference, the federal government announced that Australia will finally get a space agency, which is something that many, many people pushed hard for quite a long time. Then later in 2018, it was actually announced that the space agency will be headquartered here in Adelaide, down at Lot 14 at the other end of the city. And also, During 2018, a small team around UniSA and Nova Systems started to put together a bid for a cooperative research center for smart satellites. And we were joined by a large number of very enthusiastic people and companies. And finally, in I think it was March 2019, the federal government approved funding for our research center. So we have now the SmartSat CRC, a cooperative research center for smart satellite systems. And again, it will be headquartered in Adelaide. So quite exciting what happens in Adelaide. And that is not a coincidence. This is partially because all the startup companies and other activities that we had here in Adelaide over the last years. Now, as Emily said, the second part of today will be a bit of a panel discussion where we talk about how university and industry can play along. What are the expectations? What are the roles? So the first half is supposed to be a bit of an introduction to set the scene, provide some context, provide some background. So I started with a very brief history of satellite communications. So it's not just brief, it's very brief. The main reason for that is by just looking at the audience, there are a number of people here who are much better qualified to talk about the history of satellite communications than I am. So I really just point out a few milestones. So when I looked up some of the early works on not just satellite communication, but space travel and satellites in general, I came across a book from a person called Hermann Potocznik, is my assumption of the correct pronunciation. And that gives me a bit of a home advantage because he was born in the Austrian-Hungarian Empire in 1892. Unfortunately, poor Hermann died in great poverty in 1929 in Vienna. So, but don't let it be a distraction when it comes to enthusiasm for space. So Hermann published a book in 1928 under his German name, Hermann Nordung, Das Problem der Befahrung des Weltraums der Raketenmotor, or in a more understandable language, the problem of space travel, the rocket engine. So it's a lot about rockets, as you can imagine, but he also talks about orbits. And here, one of the first figures here is pretty much a simple explanation that if you have a circular orbit and you spin around that orbit with a particular velocity, and then you have a force basically pushing the body outwards, you have gravity pushing the body in. If they are the same, then you basically have a free orbit and you have a satellite orbiting the Earth. So that's fairly well understood. A bit later, he actually also said, well, there's one particular orbit which is roughly 36,000 kilometers above the surface of the Earth, where a complete revolution takes exactly 24 hours. So if you manage to place this orbit above the equator, and if you turn in the right direction, so same direction as the Earth, then you basically have your so-called geostationary orbit, where nothing moves relative to each other. And I like actually how he explained it here on the figure on the right, because it's a bit hard to see here, but he basically said you can imagine a very, very tall tower where at the very top of the tower you have, without gravity, just an object floating at the same position over the Earth. And he didn't think about communications here, but he said that could be used as a space observatory where you can observe the Earth. So basically he was talking about Earth observation. Interestingly enough, later on he designed how this Earth observatory, a space observatory, would look like. And he also talked about telecommunications. He didn't talk about broadcasting things or providing communications, but he recognized the need to be able to send the observations you do down to Earth. And one of the solutions he had was we could use light. We could use flashing lights and mirrors. But he identified that this might be unreliable because you could have cloud coverage and then it doesn't work. So it's a very topical thing because we talk about optical communication, free space optical, cloud coverage, and so on. He then proposed radio waves might be a better way, especially since with your solar power plant you have as much energy as you want. And because there's no gravity, you can build very large antennas. So that didn't really work that well, but he had very good ideas there. Anyway, so these ideas were then brought forward towards telecommunications, and that was by the fairly famous paper in October 1945 by Arthur Clarke. And Arthur Clarke basically published the paper Extraterrestrial Relays, where he said, look, if we have three stations, station 1, 2, and 3, orbiting the Earth, and we offset them by like 120 degrees, then we can have global coverage if they all are in a geostationary orbit. So three geostationary satellites could provide global coverage. Also interestingly, he already had radio links between the satellites in this paper, so satellite-to-satellite communication, something which we didn't have for quite a while. Now that was a theory. That was 1945. Now, it was not easy to build that at the time. And just a few first steps here. So in 1957, we basically had the first satellite with a radio transmitter, Sputnik 1, which has the catalog number 2 in the system. The reason being that the Sputnik 1 launch vehicle has catalog number 1. That simply transmitted some telemetry. 1 year later, 58, we had Project SCORE, which was the first communication satellite. It pretty much had a tape recorder, or two tape recorders on board, recorded a message, and played it back down to Earth. And both of them were on fairly low orbits. And 1964, SYNCOM 3 was now the first geostationary. So that flew all the way out in a geostationary orbit and was used to relay signals there. Then the big takeoff, if you can to the next slide. Yeah. The big takeoff was pretty much in the 70s and 80s. So in 1971, we had the launch of the first GPS satellite. I'm sure many of you have used GPS satellite even today, perhaps to find the venue here. And in the 70s and 80s, satellite TV pretty much brought satellite communications to the consumer market. People put a dish on their roof, and you could have one satellite illuminating a whole continent broadcasting TV channels. And of course, there are many, many more, but two more I'd like to highlight here. One is 2005, Inmarsat BGAN. So BGAN stands for Broadband Global Area Network. And on the right-hand side here, you actually see the footprint of the BGAN system. So forget about these little spots here. These are just some technicality. But the big colored circles here, areas here, these are the footprints of three satellites providing coverage of the Earth. So if you think about back 1945, Arthur Clarke's paper, that's exactly what it is. It just took 60 years to get it up and running completely. And finally, one which is actually supposed to launch next year, Viasat 3. So I pointed out because that is designed to have a total throughput of 1 terabit per second. So just to give you an idea of the data rates we get in satellite communications. So that's on the international scene. Where's Australia? Again, just a very few selected examples. 1967 was the first satellite Australia launched, and that put Australia on the map as the third nation that launched its own satellite from its own territory. So it was launched up in Woomera. And then what you see in the video here as well on the right-hand side, 2002, we had the launch of FedSat. That came actually out of a cooperative research center, the CRC for satellite systems. And the ground station of that and the payload developed, that was done by ITR up in Mawson Lakes. So in fact, we use the ground station right now. And I think some in the audience actually were quite involved in this project. And finally, one more recent one, or two recent ones, the two SkyMaster satellites that complement the NBN to provide internet access to remote areas. They have been launched in 2015. And just to give you an idea of the order of magnitude, so one SkyMaster satellite has an overall throughput of 80 gigabit per second. So 160 gigabit in total. So you know now who was involved in the FedSat before. So what's changing now? It sounds like it's all well working. We have satellites in lower Earth orbits. We have satellites in geostationary orbits. We have worldwide coverage. We have TV signals. We have navigation signals, and so on. So what's the challenging, what's the interesting part right now? And to understand it or to look at that, we have to have a closer look at satellite orbits. When people talk about low Earth orbit, geostationary orbit, so how far is that actually? So this figure should show that fairly well, I hope, if it's readable. But I don't expect you to read all the details here. So you have here, well, the Earth, obviously. So we have roughly 6,400 kilometer radius of the Earth. And then this very small blue area here, this is what we call the low Earth orbit. So this is an orbit where we have the International Space Station, we have the Hubble Space Telescope, and we have many satellites, CubeSats that we launch now. They are all somewhere here in this low Earth orbit. So really fairly close to the surface of the Earth. And since they are so close, they're actually fairly fast. So they spin around the Earth in like an hour, 1.5 hours, something like that. Then we have not much for quite a while, just in this green area, which we call this the medium Earth orbit. The only relevant satellites, I would say, there are all the navigation satellites, GPS, Galileo, GLONASS. they are approximately 20,000 kilometers, so it's quite a distance, and they orbit the Earth in 12 hours, roughly. And then at the very end, just exactly between the green zone and the red zone here, we have this geostationary orbit. So at roughly 36,000 kilometers, where we have all the satellites that basically are fixed in the sky, provide like the SkyMaster system or TV satellites. And immediately you see, when you talk about a low Earth orbit or a geo, there's quite some difference. The LEO is just this tiny part here. The geostationary is all the way over there. So if, say, we look at the LEO with, say, 600 kilometer altitude and the geostationary with 36,000, there's a factor of 60 in distance. So it's quite a different problem. Also, just referring to the lower part of this figure, which is a zoomed out version. So here the geo is just here. And here you have the moon at 384,000 kilometers, if I'm correct. So the moon is another 10 times further away. So just keeping that in mind when you talk about, let's fly to the moon, let's do something like that. It's quite some distance. And I'm not even talking about Mars here. Now, what's so special about this geostationary orbit? And there are basically two things. The two things are nothing moves, which is for communications people typically a good thing, and a large footprint. So what I mean by that, the satellite sees a large part of the Earth, or vice versa, the satellite is seen from a large area of the Earth. So if you would like to provide global coverage, if you would like to broadcast satellites, a TV signal, perfect. The disadvantage, there's no disadvantage. No. The disadvantage is basically distance. It's just far away. And there are two aspects or two problems you get when you talk about distance. One is so-called free space path loss, which is pretty much the further you transmit, the weaker your signal gets. And the relationship is a quadratic one, which means if you double the distance, you have to transmit four times as much to get the same signal at your receiver. 10 times the distance, 100 times more power required. Now, you say, okay, that's fine, quadratic relationship, not too bad. But let's put it into perspective. I said before the difference between a low Earth orbit, 600 kilometer, and a geo is roughly a factor of 60. So if we square 60, we get 3,600. So we have to transmit with 3,600 times more power to get the same signal. Now that would mean if you have a small sensor, like the ones Alex will most likely talk about a bit later, a factor of 3,600 is the difference between changing the battery once every 10 years or once every day. So it is a very, very significant difference here. And perhaps you could work on that. You can come up with better batteries, you have solar panels, you have all kinds of things, you can build better antennas and so on. But there's another very fundamental issue, and that is latency. Basically, how long does it take a signal to go all the way up to the satellite and down? And to illustrate that, when I was flying from Adelaide to Sydney once, on Qantas you have on many flights now free Wi-Fi and free internet connectivity. So I took my phone out and ran a speed test while being on a plane, because what else do you do? That was the result, the screenshot here. So I used the Qantas free Wi-Fi and I connected to an internet server here in Adelaide to test my internet connectivity. I had a download of 16.4 megabit per second, which is actually pretty good for many areas. I had an upload of basically nothing, and I had a ping of 667. So that means from my phone up to the satellite, down to a ground station, which is a Viasat ground station, via fibers to Adelaide, and all the way back, took 667 milliseconds. But actually, like 120, 125 milliseconds is one way from the plane up to the satellite. So we do that up, down, and then up, down, back. So out of these 667 milliseconds, we have roughly 500 just for going up and down to this geostationary satellite. And there's really nothing you can do about it, because speed of light, as long as you can't break that, and I'm pretty sure we can't, this is something you have to live with. And for some communications problems, this is simply not good enough. Even if you have a telephone conversation and you get routed via a satellite, it's just 500 milliseconds. It's just starts to get a bit inconvenient when you want to have a decent conversation. Now, what can we do? We bring the satellites closer. But we know then things are moving and things have a smaller footprint. So how does it look? This is here a simple animation of one of these geostationary satellites. So this is actually an Inmarsat satellite from the Beacon system I showed before. And you see it moves exactly with the same speed as the Earth. It illuminates, or it sees essentially half the globe almost, and everything is very nice stationary relative to each other. Now, the second example I have here in a second is one of the Starlink satellites that are brought up by SpaceX for the new internet in the sky. Well, that's one of those. So you see, it moves fairly fast, and that's not a different time scale, that's the same time scale. It moves very fast, and you have a very, very small footprint there. So how do you set up a communication system with something that you see once in a while and it just pops out on the horizon and 10 minutes later it's gone again? And the answer is quite simple, lots of them. So you just put a whole mesh up there, and this is a screenshot from a person in the UK who analyzed some of the Starlink parameters. You put a whole mesh up there, many different orbits. In each orbit you have many different satellites, and they all fly around the Earth, which means if you sit on the planet, you always see a number of satellites up there. And we're not talking 3, 4, 5. We're not talking about tens or hundreds. We're talking about thousands of satellites in these orbits. And these satellites start to talk to each other. So not just down to the ground and up, but also the neighboring satellites. So that means basically a signal goes up to this network. It goes in the lower Earth orbit, gets forwarded by one satellite to the next one, comes down again at the destination. And this particular screenshot here, it's a longer video, it's quite interesting actually, but this particular screenshot talks about how long does it take for a signal to go from New York to London. And the numbers here on the right-hand side says, in the current internet, the round-trip time, so for a signal to go back and forth, is 76 milliseconds. If you would have a fiber going on the surface of the Earth in the shortest possible way, you would end up with 55 milliseconds, and the satellite system could, in theory, provide 46 milliseconds. Now you might ask, hang on a second, surely it must be longer if I go up, around, and down again. But unfortunately, the speed of light in a fiber is only roughly 70% of the speed of light in vacuum or in air. So that basically means, yes, it is further from a distance point of view to go up, around, and down, but from a time point of view, you're actually faster going through air. Of course, there are some assumptions that processing time is pretty much zero and so on. But at least it's a theoretical limit that could be achieved. So it's all about latency and having this fully connected network. Now, if you have many satellites, we have to make them smaller, we have to make them cheaper. And these are the only two props I have here. This here, which is on the left-hand side, that's a communications module from FedSat. So that one launched in 2002. That was designed and constructed at UniSA. That's the UHF RF module from FedSat. And where is it? This one is more powerful. Which is not quite, that has a higher transmit power, but that one includes the same UHF components, and it includes also the baseband processor, which actually here is a second box of that one. So that one doesn't have any components in there. If you look closely, I couldn't find a loaded one in the lab. But that's pretty much the size. I'm not sure if Matt, you have one of those lying around. You do. So that was from a launch in 2002 to something that has been designed, I think, actually in 2017, 2018. So we really got significantly smaller. Now, I would like to just mention two, actually one example project and a second one about talking smaller and cheaper to introduce basically my two colleagues who were kind enough to join me today for the presentation and for the panel discussion afterwards. So the first one was the Global Sensor Network, which was a really, really exciting project we did at ITR at UniSA, where we got funding from the Australian Space Research Project, and the task was to design a space-based sensor network that can basically pick up data from very small, very cheap sensors on the ground. So we started with blank piece of paper, did some simulations, did a lot of signal processing, put some kit into planes that DSD gave us for testing, built some prototypes. Would have brought one, actually, fairly large boxes. That was our idea of having a small sensor at the time, or at least a prototype. Had some satellite from one of our partners and tested the whole thing. And the result of that was basically the spin-off company Myriota, where Alex will talk more about that. The second part is about making things smaller and cheaper. So that here on the left-hand side, that is FedSat. That was a satellite launched in 2002, quite a big thing. That on the right-hand side was one of the CubeSats, roughly the size of a small shoebox or so, that Matt Tetlow and Inovor built. So I would like to ask now my two guest speakers or co-presenters. First one, Alex Grant. So Alex is the CEO of Myriota, so the company that came out of UniSA from this global sensor network. And after that, I would like to ask Matt Tetlow. So Matt is the CEO of Inovor Technologies, who is an Adelaide company building CubeSats.
So I'm going to tell you very quickly a little bit about Myriota. So we're a spin-out from the University of South Australia. And we are in the business of addressing this problem of data collection. And this is state-of-the-art data collection for farmers up north in South Australia. You're literally seeing the best that we can do, you know, until now, which is driving the ute out, throwing the ladder up the side of the tank and having a look, and then driving 200 kilometres back to the homestead. And by the way, you might have 100 of those tanks. And in some properties, we've had some equipment installed up in the northern part of Western Australia, they employ people who that's their job, drive utes around to see that there's water for livestock to be drinking. Now, I don't know about you, that seems like bullcrap today. Like, really? That's what we're doing? So that's just a bit of a motivational example around the need for having data communication anywhere, whether it's on the Earth's surface, at sea. And we've seen that there are already things like Inmarsat began. Sidebar, ITR did R&D that went into the BGAN waveform development. There's some people sitting here and actually myself working on helping Inmarsat with some of that. Why don't they use that equipment and solve the problem? We saw it has complete coverage. Very good question. I'm glad you all are onto it and are asking the good questions. So the problem is it's too expensive. It was built for satellite phones and using your laptop, so it's built for human broadband communication. And it wasn't really built for battery operation. So back to that distance thing. If you want a battery that lasts a few hours or a day, that's fine. If I want to install a thing on something that's hundreds of kilometres away that's expensive to go and visit and change the battery, well, if I'm doing that, then I don't need the radio. I can just go and look at it. So it really doesn't solve the problem. Technically it does, economically it doesn't. On top of that, if you use things like cellular communications, or there's new systems called low power wide area communications that aim to have a very, very long battery life, that involve an Internet of Things device talking to some kind of access point or tower, that's great. But if the sensor or the device you might be tracking an animal or tracking a shipping container, it's going in and out of coverage, that's just an operational nightmare. So while you've got coverage, you're good. You've got to deal with the fact that, well, sometimes it just goes completely off the radar. Where's my thing? I don't know. It's at sea. I don't know where it is. Where's my, you know, where's my cows? Have no idea. Oh, there's one. Oh, no, gone again. Don't know. So this is really the problem that Myriota aims to solve. And the way we do it, and we've heard a lot about satellite communications, is small thing on the ground communicating very, very low power signals to a satellite in low Earth orbit in one of these 500-600 kilometre orbits that can collect data from millions of devices like this on the ground and bring that down into the cloud and then push that to the customer. And so when we say, we've all got our little bits of technology that we want to show. When we say a small device on the ground, we're not mucking around. We mean a small device on the ground. Now, back row probably can't see that. No, there is actually something there. You have a look at that later. If anyone wants to buy some of these, can fix you up. That's a bit of a game changer. You know, you've got a really tiny Internet of Things device. It's got a microprocessor on board. You can interface it to sensors. It's got memory. You can build a data logger on that. Some of you here, if you've got a technical bent, you might like mucking around with Arduinos and Raspberry Pis. If you can do that, you can get one of our developer kits and write code on this that can read a temperature sensor that you can go down to JCAR or whatever, buy a temperature sensor, integrate it with this, and actually send it over satellite. So you can find out what temperature it is in your backyard via satellite link, if that's the thing that floats your boat. All very exciting. Lots of devices on the ground, and doing this thing at really, really low power is kind of requires a bit of technical wizardry. That was some of the research and development that was done at UniSA. And you remember that big white Pelican case, which was like this, had a golf buggy battery in it. That was the prototype. And in the small number of years since starting Myriota, that's gone to this. We'll come back to what battery life we're achieving. So we saw some stuff about Starlink and whatnot. This is the constellation that we're building. It's very easy to get carried away with what crazy people in the US are doing, but this is what crazy people in Australia are doing. We have 4 satellites on orbit already today, providing service to customers. And then the next 3 satellites are these ones here. It's about, not quite real size, but about almost 1-to-1 size on the screen, that will start launching later this year. So this will be a constellation in the next phase of 25 satellites that will provide coverage for Internet of Things devices globally, with a revisit time of about 5 minutes. And following on from that, as you build that constellation out, we'll have real-time coverage with a constellation of about 50 satellites. So that's all very exciting. So sort of coming back to, you know, Myriota, and we might have a discussion about this later around, you know, it's good to check in. So we've had a spin out from the university. Well, how's that going? It's been in R&D. The program at ITR started in 2011, and great case study of government investing in R&D that's led to commercialization. Closed our first direct to orbit link in some of the stuff that Gottfried showed you in 2013. And it's been in paying customers' hands since 2016. The company was spun out in 2015. Now employs 25 people. We might be at the crossover where the spin-out's bigger than the research lab, which is great, and we need more of that. How's the technology doing? 15-year battery life. So we're literally with a battery life that starts becoming a bit academic. The shelf life of the battery is kind of 10 to 15 years. So it starts becoming a little bit theoretical. We have a system that can push 100 million IoT messages per day through the class of CubeSat that I just showed you. I've talked about the satellites we have in orbit and ones that are on their way. We're getting some really interesting people involved with the company, including Pam Melroy, former shuttle commander and pilot, who's joined our board. And in terms of leveraging up from an initial investment in UniSA research now to private capital raised, just from the private market investment into the company. Also, side note, this is to get it to a prototype. This is to get it to start to enter market. So university commercialization departments, take note. And the size of the investment, is what it is. What's more important is that's coming from Australia, so Main Sequence Ventures, which is the VC fund set up out of CSIRO, Right Click Capital, just institutional VC, South Australian VC fund, leading our Series A round, which also included Boeing and Singtel, which is great. So not just Australian money, also international money. If you are interested, you can go onto GitHub, get the SDK, download it, muck around with it. If you're super interested, you can buy a dev kit. And then if you're in the business of actually making product to ship to people, you can do that too. Leading to, these are some of the third-party products. So this is really a supply chain where we're providing an enabling technology that's now hitting market inside other people's products as a connectivity solution, which is exciting. All right, I think that's it for me. I've taken enough of your time, and I'll hand over to Matt Tetlow from Inovor. Thank you, sir.
Hello. Hi, everyone. So I guess I'll just reiterate what Gottfried was saying before, that the space industry is changing a little bit. So traditional spacecraft, there's the exquisite one on the left here is Hubble, and that's an enormous bus-sized spacecraft. But your traditional sort of run-of-the-mill satellites were typically the size of a fridge. And now Space 2.0, we're kind of making spacecraft the size of a loaf of bread. And as Alex has pointed out, they have basically all the technology in the larger spacecraft. They're just very, very compact. So I guess just wanted to talk a little bit about why we do what we do. So the first one has to be, it's the selfish thing that we love doing space, right? So there's an element, and I think probably a lot of people in the room are kind of share that sort of sentiment, that it's really cool being in the space industry. So to be fair, the first reason we do it is because this is what we want to be doing. The other thing is, Australia should be a world leader in space technology. It frustrates me when it's sort of seen as such an achievement to get a company from the US or Europe to come over here, set up and do something here, when it's so much more value to the state if someone develops the R&D. If we develop the R&D here, we commercialize it, we have the supply chain here, everybody in the state benefits from it, right? So there's absolutely no reason why we shouldn't be doing it. We need to be developing all the high-tech things here in South Australia. We need to back the South, well, in Australia generally, but specifically South Australia. We need to back all the companies. Anyone who's got a great idea, we should back them, get out there, get an industry going, and basically build an ecosystem. And we have what we need. The skilled people are, there are plenty of skilled people around in everything from space medicine, law. We have engineers, scientists, everybody able to do what we need done. There's a government basically that's back in the space industry at the moment. So we were kind of, I was at a workshop recently talking about what we need, and are the universities producing the right kinds of students? And I say absolutely they are. We have, from the grad levels, sort of the first sort of 10 years of their careers, they exactly what we need. They're skilled with the right, whether it's software, mechanical, electrical, optics, comms, RF, whatever, they're all available. So, we have exactly what we need. So we've basically, got a group of primarily South Australian educated people in our team. So we are a team of 20, and almost all of us are from educated in South Australia, including myself. Well, I'm part educated in other parts of the world, perhaps by my accent, but most of my education was here in South Australia. And as I said, we have the team that can do all the fundamental science and technology areas that we require, we have access to here in the state. So that's really the important thing, I think, is building a team that kind of has the skills and has the drive to develop the technology, which obviously Alex would have gone through the same exercise. So these are all our Australian-made parts. So this is the one that Gottfried showed you before. This is the flight version, or the final version of the UHF comm system, and it's a little bit smaller than what Gottfried showed you before. But these are the, sort of the key technologies that we have developed here in South Australia, and they are manufactured here. So this is an attitude determination control system. So this, it's got a star tracker and three reaction wheels and a whole lot of electronics in it. So essentially, this star tracker, which is this size, you can point it at any part of the sky, and it can tell you within a fraction of a degree which way you're pointing. So that's really, really important for imaging type applications where you want to take a photo of the thing you want to take a photo of. And then then the reaction wheels are basically the control system that changes the spacecraft. If you accelerate the wheel in one direction, the spacecraft will pitch up in the other direction. So you have these wheels spinning at different speeds in different axes, and you can basically change the way the spacecraft points. This is a main mission computer. So these two go together to get what's called our main mission module, which is essentially the whole system that commands the spacecraft. So the first time this will be flown will be using Gottfried or UniSA's ground station. So that'll basically talk up through the ground station to that comms module and then go to the main mission module, and then that'll tell the spacecraft what to do. And that's got all the tasking, it's got all the telemetry, all the health checking, check what the spacecraft's doing and what the state of the payload is, what the temperatures are like, what the battery charge is, you know, how fast is the battery discharging, all that kind of thing. And this is the power system. So this is a 50 watt hour battery, and this is a nine channel solar charger. So just like the inverter that you got on the side of your house, that's exactly the same thing. We are commanding much smaller solar panels, so we don't have quite the current flowing through it. So the important thing is that these are all systems that are made here in Australia, and specifically in South Australia. So what we provide is the entire spacecraft platform, you'd call it. So the power system, the pointing system, the primary structure, and this mission control telemetry and control communications link. So if Alex and I were to build a spacecraft together, these parts would combine with his advanced comms radio, put them together, and you make a spacecraft out of it. So a couple of the missions that we are building, so this is kind of a similar construct to what I just mentioned. This is the CSIRO spacecraft. So they came to us and said they want to fly a shortwave infrared sensor. So they want this sensor, this imager, and this processor board, and can we make it into a satellite for them? So we've basically taken all of those, integrated all the satellite platform technology that we have, and we've produced a spacecraft. So this is going to be launched in just under a year. Out of the US, and we kind of just are starting production. So some of that hardware that you saw before is sort of the engineering models of the spacecraft. This is one that we're building for the Department of Defense. Now this is now 12 units, so it's roughly the size of a slab of beer, or a little bit smaller, half a slab of beer. And it's an imaging spacecraft. So what you can do with these sorts of small miniaturized technologies, when they're such small parts, you can actually package them up into just the bare minimum volume and mass to do the task that you need. So traditionally on a spacecraft, you'd have what would be called the bus, and it would be like a box with some shelves in it, and then it'd have a space to put your payload, right, whatever it was. But because these are much lower cost systems, you actually can completely integrate everything, all the support features, which are the bus, around the payload, what you need. So this thing is essentially a flying telescope. So about 70% of the volume of that is just telescope, and in fact, it's space because you've got a primary mirror at the top primary mirror at the bottom, a secondary mirror up the top, and then all our electronics and bus parameters all kind of packaged around it. So this is another way that the space industry is changing. We're kind of going from these standard platforms that cost, you know, many millions of dollars to make, so you can't sort of remake them, to be these sort of much more optimized platforms to be, you know, so that you have as little as possible beside the payload up in space, because that's kind of what you want there. And of course, mass is money, so you've got to keep the spacecraft as small and light as possible. This is the final one, which is a SCIRIS, which is an Earth imaging application. So they're essentially looking down and basically taking photos of the Earth. I didn't actually mention what Hyperion was. Hyperion is this one back here, is a space object detection. So it's essentially going around in low Earth orbit, looking out at the geostationary orbit and managing what objects are near high-value assets. So defence obviously has a paranoia about other people's spacecraft being close to their important spacecraft. So they want to know where everything is at all times. So this is a unique capability. This capability, once deployed, it's a small constellation, will be unique and no one else in the world will have it. So we're really happy to be involved in it. All right, I think I was done. Cool. Thank you.
Thank you. So, and the reason why actually people like Alex and Matt and Myriota and Inovor are here today is because they both have a relationship working with the university, working in particular with UNISA and ITR. In fact, we recently, or still have, actually, in the case of Inovor, have a staff member working a few days a week in the company to work on their problems, which is something that Emily might perhaps talk about afterwards briefly. The Future Industries Accelerator Mobility Scheme that basically supports university industry interaction. Now, just one more slide before handing over to Emily for the panel discussion. SmartSat CRC, I brought it up a few times. And of course, one of the exciting things now over the next 7 years here in Adelaide and in Australia in general. And this one slide is just to highlight the problem, which is the SmartSat CRC system, if you want. It takes quite some time to place all the logos there. So here in the center, these are our core partners from industry and academia. In the first circle around here, we have supporting partners, basically they vary a bit in the amount of contribution. And in the last one, we have startup companies. And then outside, we have other agencies and national and international agencies which are related in one way or the other. Also take note that Myriota is no longer classified as startup in this picture. Now, the main question when it comes to that, we have here approximately 90 partners, universities, startup companies, multinationals like Airbus, BAE Systems, and so on. So how do they all work together? What is their role in this ecosystem? And I think this is pretty much the time to hand over to Emily to have a bit of a discussion of how can industry and academia basically collaborate with each other.
I've got a few questions here that I would like to ask, but then don't worry, we're going to open up for questions from the audience, so please get ready with your questions. This is an opportunity. One of the things that I think is really highlighted in that last slide that you showed there Gottfried, was around the opportunities with something like the SmartSat CRC, but I'd really like to hear from each of you about how you think what roles academia, startups, government, and larger companies have in shaping this ecosystem. So I don't know if you want to start with this question, Matt.
Sure. So I mean, I think you know it's as I said before, it's about an ecosystem, and it's not so startups, academia, large industry, and there's also the supply chain. I mean, that's kind of the key part of this. And I think universities should be out there doing the next thing. So there are some universities kind of playing in the developing what already exists space, and I kind of think that's just a waste of everybody's time and money. They should be out there developing the next thing, which then gets commercialized into technology that becomes an industry and provides seed technology into industry. I think large industry should be trying to, draw in supply chain from around Australia, particularly in the space technologies area. Sort of try and see how they can support the local industry getting space technology in. And I think startups need to be sitting in between there, seeding, getting the smart research from the universities or wherever it comes from, and basically commercializing it and then getting into the primes. And I think in all cases, government needs to be a buyer, a customer. We don't. Having grant schemes where they hand you out money to do this and say, oh, that's all good and well, but what we really need is a customer. You need to have a change in mindset to say, all right, we need to be buying things from Australian companies because that's how you basically get the industry to grow.
Excellent.
I think there's a real opportunity with programs like CRCs that they're large scale, and there's challenge, as you pointed out, is many partners. But really there's an opportunity for a framework for industry, academia, government, to work together on real problems of national importance. And if you just rewind the clock, so you had the CRC for satellite systems, it was a different CRC, but the number of people who that touched and then went on into positions of leadership in government, in industry, in defence, or then now starting companies, like it's incredible. That was a much smaller CRC to some extent. So there's a real opportunity here for 1,000 flowers to bloom out of the CRC. The thing I get excited by is the opportunity for collaboration. With whoever actually, and having resource and a framework to do that in is fantastic.
Excellent. Do you want to comment as well, Gottfried?
Sure. Mine is still on. I think the universities, I completely agree with Matt. We have to look at the next thing and not just do what basically what should be done in the commercial sector in just spinning something out. The other thing I think universities are really great for in the whole ecosystem is providing some support to, for example, startup companies. If you have a startup company with like 3, 4, 5 people, you don't have an expert in every field. If you look at the university, we have experts in telecommunications, in virtual reality, in user interface, in sleep, in thin film coating, whatever it may be. So I think universities should be there if a startup company says, look, we have a particular great idea, we have to drive that, but we need some support in one area where we just don't have the expertise. So I think this is something where universities really should contribute.
I absolutely agree. I think there's lots of opportunities where Australia can be a leader in that, so it was great to hear that. But I'd really be interested to hear, and I'm sure others in the audience would, where you think there might be the greatest opportunities for Australia to play into this global game right now?
There's a lot of opportunity. One of the things that the space industry generally and in Australia particularly has struggled with is, what is it about? You get a lot of space companies selling space stuff to other space companies, but that's got to root down to value on the ground at some point. In our case, we're focusing on comms. Earth observation, navigation, timing are all things that we all use on a daily basis. And Australia is really well positioned in a number of areas. We have a strong heritage in communications, strong both in terms of satellite comms and ground station networks, in a very interesting part of the world geographically to provide support both for CommSat ground station and also deep space missions, which you've had a long history of doing, and it's probably not as well known as it should be. Moving beyond that, we're seeing the emergence of really exciting stuff. Matt's doing building spacecraft.
So I just echo that. I think from a comms perspective, I think we are in a very useful location on Earth to capitalise on future high data rate comms. We have very little cloud cover and all those sorts of things. So I think sort of this very high data rate comms is something that we would benefit from, or somewhere that the world's going. I mean, if you look at like some of these applications we use, like the Earth observation ones, they are so reliant on huge data pipes to get the data down, and that's far and away, like on CyroSat 1, the one that I showed you first, far and away the limit on that is the downlink capacity. So we can only operate the spacecraft for about 6 minutes a day collecting data. Okay, it's got this hyperspectral imager, so it sucks in data at 60 frames a second. But you can only operate for that amount of time, and then you've got to spend the rest of the day downloading the data, ready for the next day to basically collect. So if you kind of improve that, you know, the utilization or the utility of the spacecraft goes up drastically. I guess the only other thing I think is something that's worth mentioning is there's a lot of very strong, you know, AI and machine learning kind of applications here in South Australia in particular. We're sort of associated with the Australian Institute for Machine Learning as well, and they recently there was a project posted by ESA to estimate the pose of a spacecraft. So this is a very important thing when we're talking about debris removal, to be able to go up to a spacecraft and you've got something that's got to grab on it, but it can't see it. It's got to work out which way it's facing and try and sort of work out how to grab this thing. So this pose estimation is something that ESA have been working on for a long time. And they basically posed this problem, and just two grad students down at the uni there at AIML solved this problem, and basically, you know, better and faster than anybody else. And they were competing against MIT, Stanford, all of the top universities in the world. So I think we also have some really good AI capability here in the state, which we need to leverage, work out, you know. There's a lot of young students here. I can see them. You guys and girls need to go out and, you know, work out an application and get a business going.
Excellent.
I think I can add to the communications problem. So part of the CRC, I'm currently visiting some other research organizations, universities, but also companies, and this is a common problem. You have so much data you generate on the spacecraft, you can't get it down. Say, well, get some RF spectrum. Well, everyone wants that. It's super crowded there. You can't get more spectrum. So optical links, for example, are absolutely great. Also, when you go into the optics, wavelengths get shorter, which means the antennas or lenses, everything gets smaller. You can actually fit that in a small spacecraft. And I mean, I said at the very beginning with the history of Hermann Potocnik, when he was talking about the optical communications down to ground, said, well, it doesn't work because there could be cloud cover. Well, Australia is a really, really good place for not having cloud cover. So I think we have really a great opportunity here to, for example, have a network, and ANU, for example, is driving that at the moment, have a network of optical ground stations, which we can use to download our own data, but also provide a service to everyone else who needs access to data.
I want to come back to a comment you made at the start of the answer to that question there, Alex, where you said that that there's probably a few things that we have to understand about ourselves in terms of the space industry in Australia. And the next question I've got here is, what do you think we need for a well-developed space ecosystem in Australia?
That's a real good question. We need... So first of all, we have a developing ecosystem. And that's scaling up as we're getting more and more activity. And so really what the next step for us is scale, which is investment, which of course is then people chasing opportunity. So that's really about people addressing customer demand ultimately and getting money into the system to deliver products, which, you know, Australia spends a massive amount of cash on spacey kind of stuff that everyone here benefits from. So, you know, we've got defence programs, we've got civilian programs. You know, we're getting higher resolution positioning services. That's one of the big investments the federal government's making. So, you know, these are billion-dollar programs. SkyMaster's another one. That, historically, and even in a contemporary sense, is big sums of money going to primes that are not Australian, and in fact very little Australian content. And I think the next step for Australia to really grow up, and you will see a massive boost, is, as when you were saying, the government starts being a customer of Australian companies for some of this stuff. Can an Australian company today build the next SkyMaster satellite? Probably not today. Could we contribute components to something like that? Absolutely. Could we build it in the future? Yeah, maybe. So I think, you know, the emergence of Australian primes that can do these larger projects, I think, will be really critical.
I think one of the important things Alex mentioned was scale. Yeah. And as you mentioned, people. So cash is one thing, and it's great if you have the opportunity to basically drive some big projects. And then next question is, you need people. So, and I mean, we talked before about the roles of the university, of startup, of industry. The role of the university here, and it's not just the university, because it's a whole education system. We have to start in, not in year 12, but in year, I don't know, one ideally, to actually have a pipeline of students. It's insanely hard to have really good people in this area. I mean, I'm not sure about you when you hire people, how many applications you get. You might get many, because Myriota is always in the news. but it is very hard to get people. And this is part of the ecosystem that you have highly qualified people who are good to go to work on these projects.
This is a super important point, right? So people sometimes talk about Myriota as commercializing technology out of UniSA, and that's kind of true to some extent. Well, actually commercializing is people out of UniSA.
Yes. Right?
So, you know, the second most valuable thing that came out of UniSA into Myriota was the technology and IP. The first most valuable thing was the people, and actually the ongoing connection then with future further generations of people. So this is super. This is everything. Without people, you don't have anything.
I think we've got two very clear messages there: buy Australian, and support developing talent in Australia as well, which is going to be really important. So I'd like to just before we go over to the audience, I want to come back to the SmartSat CRC, because I think this is a really exciting opportunity for the space industry in Australia. We know it's our largest research collaboration in space in Australia. And just to ask from each of you what your expectations are from SmartSat CRC, and particularly for your own companies.
I kind of touched on it before, I guess. I mean, there are some pieces of technology that we are looking to get support developing. Some of them are kind of, you know, very close to some of the subsystems that we make. But we're also very interested, I guess, in the comms side of things and the network. So basically everything that UniSA is good at. UniSA is probably good at all sorts of other things as well. But I mean, on the comms side, they would be second to none in Australia, certainly. And I think it's very interesting the technology that comes out of that in so much as how it supports our future platforms. So, I think the CRC will provide those sorts of technologies, I guess, which we know. So those are the things that we know we don't know that we're keen to get from the CRC. And then we want about the unknown unknowns. So what's the next thing? And this is what I think the universities are going to come up with, you know, some researchers are going to come up with some, you know, new, I don't want to use the word leapfrog because that's kind of the space agency's favorite term, but you know, some of these next technologies, we don't know what they are yet, and it's really important. And this is why you back these sorts of projects, because you don't know what's going to come out of them. You know some of the things that have come out of them, but what are the other things? And those may be the defining moments of the CRC are going to be developing these, you know, other unique pieces of technology. So I guess, you know, the known unknowns and the unknown unknowns is what I want from the CRC.
Yeah, I think there's a real opportunity to do some things of national scale and significance in the CRC, applying space technologies to some problems of national importance. You know, if the SmartSat CRC doesn't do something like that, I'd be disappointed. I really am looking forward to seeing a new wave of students, graduate students, going out and turbo boosting companies like ours. And I'm also looking for, you know, the next generation of researchers to go and start the next 10 Myriotas. That's what I'm looking for.
Well, I have two hats on here. One part is the, as being part of the SmartSat CRC, leading one of the three research programs there, where I think we have a unique opportunity to really bring everyone together. It's basically a focus point in Australia. And while the headquarters is in Adelaide, that does not mean that everything happens here, of course. All the other states have really, really great contributions to the CRC. My other hat is basically being a UniSA staff member, having research staff in our institute, to basically have even more industry collaboration. I mean, that all plays into our hands because ITR was always fairly defense and industry focused. But having even more research collaboration, and with a 7-year focus now of the CRC, being able to engage in longer term collaborations, more than just like a 1 or 2 year research project, which again adds to developing people and so on.
Fantastic. So We've now got time for some questions from the audience.
To all of us, but in particular to Alex, you are technological providers. And how difficult for you is to talk with the end user? And what you can do in order to improve, in order to be more close to their needs?
Customer engagement is in the DNA of the company. You know, the step one of Global Sensor Network research project was user requirements and immediately interacting with prospective end users of where's the gap in the market, what's needed, what does it look like, and you know, for any company that's super important. So sort of speaking about ourselves, constant contact with our customers. And our customers may not be the end users. Our customers are companies who are making the equipment and sensors that are then bought by people putting systems together that are then being sold to end user enterprises or individuals. At the same time, we make sure that we're always having that constant conversation with the end user, so sort of having a different layers of interaction. And that's something that we do on a daily basis. Our sales team's doing it, our marketing team's doing it, our director of product is doing it, I'm doing it, our CTO is doing it. Like, to not do that means you're just making random technology for who knows what. it's really the key to delivering value.
It's a question for SmartSat CRC. With so many partners, obviously, they all have their own agendas in terms of priorities. How are you going to select which projects that will actually cater for individual needs, but also on a national scale? Like, so it's a very challenging role.
Well, first of all, I think our industry director is here as well from the CRC. So you can correct me, Pete, if I say something wrong now. Look, I agree. It's very challenging. Obviously, every partner has their own agenda. They have their own ideas, what they would like to get out of it. But how the whole CRC started, actually, in the preparation for the bid, we had quite a large number of industry workshops where we tried to basically talk to all industry that's interested and ask them, what do you need? What would you like to see developed in a CRC? And from that, we developed our three research programs, where we basically have our milestones and our activities that we designed to deliver on pretty much what industry partners told us. Of course, now that the CSE is here, everyone tries to push, of course, their particular point. So we have criteria when we look at projects for how well is it aligned with the strategy to the CSE, is it value for money, is it well aligned with the, does it have national benefit, and so on. But I agree, this is one of the challenging things to make sure that everyone is happy, but still everyone contributes to the bigger thing and not just focusing on their own agenda.
Okay. Brendan?
Having been on both sides of the fence, so seeing the sensor network develop right from its origins within the university throughout into commercialisation, how do you reflect on the factors that make that successful in terms of the collaboration, the translation, if you like?
So in the case of getting a sizable federal government support, and like what is now on tap for SmartSat CRC, that already, to even attract that kind of investment, means you've got to have something special in the capability. So the fact that we could win that program was because ITR had a long history going back to the 80s of work in the area. But then I think the thing that really stood out for the particular story of Global Sensor Network and then Myriota was right from the start. So I'd had a previous experience with Coda Wireless, knowing how hard it is to raise money in the private market, saw this amount of money and thought, right, that's a seed investment. We want a working prototype, trained people, and end user sort of early customer engagement by the end of this project. And we had a conversation with the university, with Peter Hoy at the time, before the funding agreement was even signed, saying, right, this is the plan, we're going to do this, we're going to commercialise it. How does that sound? And had a kind of in-principle agreement, okay, well, let's give that a crack. Okay, so that's what we did, and you know, a lot of external factors had to play in an increase, a massive increase in private capital on tap in Australia, for instance. So a lot of lucky timing, right place, right time kind of stuff. But you know, I think we do need to see more of, you know, this country has about $10 billion a year going in from federal government and from universities into research. Now, some portion of that, if that on purpose approach was taken, you would see just way more commercialization. You know, it's not to say that we're not getting good outcomes, but you know, you're just not going to get commercial outcomes by accident. In my view, you'll get some, but to have things of scale, they really need to have thought and premeditation put behind them.
It's great. It's fantastic what you're doing in Australia and developing your own components. Are you guys, as part of your strategy, looking at an optical communications module, a laser comms module, as part of your suite of tools developed in Australia?
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, we kind of focused on the imaging kind of applications. So high data rate comms, whether the terahertz, optical, whatever it's going to be, that's sort of something that we're very interested in. It's not our area of expertise, and that's sort of a piece of technology that we're obviously watching very closely.
Excellent. I'd just like to finish by thanking our three presenters here, Gottfried, Alex and Matt. Really appreciate your time, your enthusiasm and your passion behind developing this, helping to contribute to this ever-developing space ecosystem in Australia, and I think that we're in good hands here. So.